University of Colorado Denver, and in Japan. First of all, thank you organizers for giving me this opportunity to talk about my recent work. Today, I'm going to be talking about convergent evolution of carnivorous plants and its molecular underpinnings. Earlier speakers mentioned already, but let me remind you that carnivorous plants evolved many times in flowering plants, from Porous, Nidarigales, Calibrales, Pericales to Ramiales. In total, 5 orders contain at least one species of carnivorous plants. And we started our research with this question. So how did carnivorous plants evolve novel traits such as digestive enzymes in independent lineages? So many of carnivorous plants can digest their captured prey. So where the digestive enzyme can come from? And our approach was to detect evolutionary trends by comparing multiple instances of carnivorous plant evolution. So what we actually did is to sample 4 species of carnivorous plants that represent 3 independent origins of carnivorous plant evolution, and we collected digestive fluid and proteins were separated like this. So each of the protein bands correspond to digestive fluid proteins. So we collected them and sequenced the partial amino acid sequences by the Edman degradation method. And in addition to that, we sequenced the transcriptomes of trap reads. And after de novo assembly, we identified the complete coding sequences that encode digestive enzymes. And this is a list of identified proteins. First of all, we noticed that there is no unique gene, no gene unique to carnivorous plants. In other words, they have homologs in non-carnivorous plants like Arabidopsis. It means that they didn't invent the evolutionary novelty from scratch, so they repurposed something that had existed in their common ancestor. And second, we found that there are a substantial overlap of gene repertory, or the repertory of proteins in independent lineages. Okay, let's see. Like purple acid phosphatases, this enzyme was found from 2 different pitcher plants, and aspartic proteases from 3 pitcher plants, GH18 and 19 chitinases and ribonucleases all from 2 different different combinations of 2 carnivorous plants, and finally glucanases and somatin-like proteins from all 4 species we examined. So to know the detailed relationships of within the gene families, we performed phylogenetic analysis, and we found that in total we analyzed 9 gene families, and of those, 3 shows orthologous relationships. So roughly speaking, orthologous means the same gene in different species, and so other 3 showed paralogous relationships, and the other 3 shows kind of combinations of orthologous and paralogous relationships. So yeah, if you compare these 2 enzymes from Australian to and Asian pitcher plants, they are orthologous. But we do have different digestive fluid protein here from Venus flytrap and Drosera, and if you compare those with Australian pitcher plants, that's a paralogous relationship. And what's surprising was that they are using orthologs very frequently. So please imagine that if you take 1 gene from a really, really large gene families, so probability of getting the same gene, orthologous genes in independent lineage is extremely low. So we hypothesized that there was a specific gene that easily repurposed for digestive function in their common ancestor. So to know, to understand the functional transitions of these enzymes from non-carnivorous ancestors to carnivorous plants, we analyzed the genes from non-carnivorous plants, Arabidopsis thaliana. And this heat map shows the transcriptional responsiveness of Arabidopsis genes, which was brought here, and in response to various stimulus, various stress treatment, including microbial infections. So, and the position of digestive fluid protein also was shown with these illustrations. And as you can see here, the ortholog proteins in Arabidopsis tend to have higher transcriptional responsiveness against many stresses, including microbial infections. And this tendency was consistent for the gene families we analyzed. So our interpretation is that almost all plants have hydrolytic enzymes to protect themselves from, for example, microbial invasions, and carnivorous plants repurposed such enzymes to degrade captured insects and finally utilize the nutrient for their reproduction and growth. Okay, and the next question is that whether digestive fluid proteins are bifunctional between different and digestive functions, or they are specialized for digestive functions. And we haven't got any solid answer yet, but the transcriptome analysis gave us some insight related to this question. So in this analysis, we sequenced the transcriptomes of two species of pitcher plant, Australian pitcher plant, and we compared the gene expressions of flat and pitcher leaves. So this species shows a phenotypic plasticity where they produce either completely flat photosynthetic leaves or carnivorous pitcher leaves. So you can compare the function gene expressions of non-carnivorous and carnivorous organs. Likewise, in Asian pitcher plants, this species doesn't have any phenotypic plasticity like Australian pitcher plants, but their leaves can be divided into the basal flat part, which is for photosynthesis, and distal pitcher part, which is, of course, for carnivory. So we can compare non-carnivorous and carnivorous functions again. And the result shows that many digestive enzymes, digestive fluid proteins, tend to preferentially or exclusively expressed in the pitcher leaves. So this indicates that at least the basal expression level is optimized for carnivorous functions. We have also analyzed the evolution of protein sequences, and during the course of phylogenetic analysis, we found something interesting. So this is a really, really simplified phylogeny of GH19 chitinases. This is Australian and Asian pitcher plants. Of course, they have independent origins. And as expected from species relationships, they have really distantly related positions. But when we use the protein sequences, they formed sister clade like this. And we found the similar trend in three different gene families, ribonuclease T2 and papoacid phosphatases. And so we hypothesized that they experienced similar selective pressure so that they can accumulate the same type of amino acid substitutions. So next we formally tested this hypothesis by quantifying the number of convergent and divergent amino acid substitutions. So these two types of substitutions are known to accumulate proportionally. So for example, example, in this phylogenetic tree, gene tree of GH19 chitinases, we compared every possible branch pairs, every possible independent branch pairs, and plotted like this. And you can draw this kind of regression line as a new hypothesis for the accumulation of convergent amino acid substitution. And as you can see here, when we compare the Australian and Asian pitcher plants, they accumulate very high number of convergent amino acid substitution relative to your new hypothesis. So under new hypothesis, the expected number of convergent amino acid substitutions are around 5, but they accumulated actually around 70, that's so many. And we repeated this analysis for 5 gene families in total, and we detected statistically significant convergence in all 3 gene families in, we detected the branch interaction. And we also analyzed the localizations of convergent amino acid substitutions on protein structures. So convergent substitutions are shown in pink colors here. And these localizations were related. We related those localizations with how exposed the protein amino acid residue is. So the varied positions are shown with blue, and exposed positions are red. And in theory, convergent amino acid substitutions tend to locate in more varied positions because such positions have many interactions with other amino acid residues and that impose a strong constraint on the amino acid substitution processes. But what we found was that, completely opposite to the prediction. We found the accumulations of convergent substitutions in more exposed positions. But we think this is making sense given the adaptations of digestive enzymes. So they have to work in digestive fluid, which is known to be highly acidic and shows high proteolytic activity, and also known to have many microbial commensals and symbionts. So in such severe conditions, they need to degrade the captured prey. So we think the substitutions, convergent substitutions at exposed position can change intermolecular interaction, maybe interactions with water molecule, interactions with protease, or interactions with some compound from microbes. And that may work to adapt in such severe microenvironment. Okay, I will finish my presentation with the famous metaphor of fitness landscape. So if the fitness landscape is really steeply sloping, the fitness optimization by stepwise random walk can find only a limited number of evolutionary pathways to attain the fitness maximum. But the fitness is gently sloping, there would be many alternative pathways. And as I showed today, the digestive enzymes experienced convergent gene repurposing and convergent expression changes, and exist convergent amino acid substitutions. So we infer that the evolution of carnivorous plants were really limited, at least in the evolution of digestive enzymes. Okay, so I performed most of experimental work related to this research project in Mitsuya's Hasebe laboratory in Japan, and I did bioinformatics analysis mainly in David Pollock's lab, and we have many collaborators, especially in genomics, and this work has been published already. And I'm going to move to Germany to start a new research group. So if you are interested in joining our team and study the evolution of carnivorous plants, please let me know. Thank you very much.
Maybe at the end.